Hello, everybody. Good evening. Can everyone hear me? How's everyone doing tonight? How are my sweet friends? Let's see what we got going on today. Carol in first, as usual, coming in at 4:30 this afternoon. Carol, that is so cool. That cracks me up. Oh, you went to the studio in Nashville yesterday and today. Oh, I want to hear what you can do. Send Brandon something to his email he sent you. I want to hear you. I want to hear what you do. That's so cool. What else do we have? We have Brandon, who is our awesome mod. We've got Glenn, who's net dude. Yeah, she beat you to it, Glenn, right? Ah, y'all are so funny. Okay, so I do have a poll up if you are on the YouTube app listening in tonight. I'll make sure I didn't just mute myself. I do that all the time. So if you would please vote and let me know what time on Tuesdays would work best for you. We don't have to do the change right away if you guys, you know, really, really, really don't want me to. But we will have to change eventually because Thursdays are going to be taken up with homeschool stuff. Plus this late at night, I am zonked. I don't know about you guys, but I'm getting old. The body's hurting. I'm ready for bed. The arthritis is angry by this time of night. So, oh, you can see my pretty girl. I love my weird Stanley. Yeah. Anyway, is mom listening? Don't tell mom, but I found her one for Mother's Day that dropped today. So I ordered it for, I got on there and I got it. I feel old, Glenn. I do, but it's just the arthritis and I've had that for a while. So, you know, it happens. Anyway, these late nights are a strain, but I really enjoy this interaction with you guys, this live streaming format. So I would prefer to work with you guys and pick something that works for you. I don't know if you guys are obviously at work during the day or, you know, on the weekends would be better for you, whatever, you know, you guys let me know if those times absolutely don't work for you and we will figure something out because you guys are special. You take the time to show up and listen to me ramble about Bible nerd stuff. I mean, that is impressive. That means a lot. So I want to be here for you guys. I want us to do this together. So let me know what you think. Again, this doesn't have to be urgent. I would like to move it earlier, sooner rather than later, just because 8:30, I'm getting tired. So y'all let me know what works for you. And I'll just look for it in the chat. Also, if you want to start doing like Q&A, even about this topic, about other topics, drop it in the chat and let me know or throw it in a comment if you're watching on replay. I love my replayers. I know you guys watch after because you can't make it at the live time and that is totally fine. I appreciate you watching it at all. Oh, that reminds me, we are 3 subscribers away from 500. And I want to say thank you so much to you guys for subscribing, for sharing it, for liking these weird little live streams we do, because I have a feeling this isn't necessarily the kind of material that YouTube wants to push out. But if you guys, you know, you guys do, you come in, you hit the like button, you share, you subscribe, you do all the good stuff. And it lets YouTube know that there are at least a few people out there that might be interested in Bible study, not just mine, but others. So, and they may even suggest other Bible study teachers that could provide you some good stuff. So I really, really, really appreciate it. Hey, John, how's it going, dude? Welcome. Yeah, just put a Q before it. That helps a lot. Just help me identify it. I mean, there's not a lot of us, so I can usually kind of keep up with it at this pace. But, you know, hopefully one day we will have enough people that would be helpful. We'll see. One day. So I do want to do a 500 subscriber giveaway because this is like the big milestone for me. It feels like we're never going to get there, but we will. So I need to pick something really special for this giveaway. So make sure you're around next week, the week after. Also stay in touch. Do the little notification bell because I may move it earlier on Thursdays until we switch it to the new day just to alleviate some of this old lady pain. Yeah, the solar eclipse on Monday was really cool. My son had a friend over for, you know, a homeschool just get together. And the neighbor was across that goes to public school was off for the day or had an excused absence or something. So they came over and we made the cereal box eclipse viewers like I used to do in elementary school. I remember doing that and I wanted it to be special. And we came out and it was really cool. There were all these people outside who helped us figure out what size hole to do. And it was just so neat having everybody get together and do the same thing at the same time and create memories. It was just really special. Yeah, it was only partial. We got to like 75%, I think. But it was really neat because the tiny little hole, you could see the little crescent cut out. It was just really, I don't know. It was just fun. It's fun with kids, you know? Daisy says, hello. She was having her dinner, so she is done and ready to party. In other words, nap. She gets bored with me and goes and lays in her little bed and naps while I live stream. You were in totality for 3 minutes? That's really cool. That's really cool. And it was a little overcast here, so I was excited that we got to see any of it. Hi, Daisy. Say hello. Hello. She got a haircut because she's wild and woolly and can't behave herself, so she had to get another haircut. But I think she looks cute. It makes her look like a puppy again, right? Yeah? You are too young for tonight's live stream, let me tell you. Tonight gets spicy. You know, it will be really exciting to have a live stream that doesn't revolve around topics that YouTube doesn't like. You know, bad things. That'd be great. It ain't happening this week, and it ain't happening next week. So just, yeah, just buckle down. We'll get through it, shall we? It's an interesting story tonight. We're on Genesis 38. Are you done with me? She's done with me already. She's bored. If she doesn't have something to chew on, she's done with me. Here we go. Studio stuff turned out great. Wow. Girl, you are rocking. You're busy. It snowed there? I'm so jealous. It's getting hot and muggy here. It already started with the raining. You know, the summer rains in Florida. Every day it rains in Florida. You get so excited thinking, yes, you know, it's pool time. We're going to the beach. Every day in the afternoon, it rains. So you got to kind of figure out your pool time around. I know. So miserable. So tough being a Floridian. Not really. But yeah, nice cool snow would be sometimes kind of fun. Maybe just every now and then. Anyway. All right. That's enough chitter chatter from me. I'm sure you guys are ready to get started. We are in Genesis chapter 38. We have, the weirdness tonight. We have some weirdness. We have Judah and Tamar, which seems like this really weird non sequitur, right? Because, hold on, let me see if that's any better. Is that any better? Because we were just talking about Joseph. We were just talking about Joseph who gets sold into slavery, shipped off down to Egypt, and then scene change. Where, what? Now we're talking about Judah? What happened? But this is going on at the same time. And what is so valuable about this, that again, this popped out to me for the first time. I've taught this so many different times, and this is the first time this particular thing jumped out at me. The reason for this lesson is to show why it was so necessary for God to get this family out of Canaan and into Egypt. This is the whole point of this lesson. This narrative is to explain why what happened to Joseph was God's will. It's absolutely amazing. We did have a tornado on the ground south of us this morning. I had to clean out the cupboard under the stairs, which we use for storage. So every time the weather gets bad, I get to dig it all out and then put it all back. So every time a tornado comes by, my closet gets cleaned out. So anybody need a lot of giant stuffed animals? No? Just me? Yeah. All right. Moving right along. Oh, my goodness. I cannot see that. Oh, all right. So Judah has, he leaves his family, which I don't know if you guys know this about that culture, but you don't leave your family. It's not like today where, you know, you get a job across the country and you go across the country after college and you settle down there or you move around. You did not leave your extended family. Your family stayed together. It was your welfare system. It was your community. It was your job. It was everything revolved around these extended families that would live together kind of in these compounds. And there are people who live like that today. I've got a friend who lives kind of on a almost a compound type area with extended family and ironically at her husband's family, which is what would have happened back then. You got married as a woman. You became a member of the husband's family. And you stayed. It was your new family. Regardless of what happened, that was your family from now on. And you didn't move away. But for some reason, Judah moves away and kind of sets up shop on his own. And he marries a Canaanite woman. Dun, dun, dun. Which we know is not going to end well. And it doesn't. He has three sons, the first of which dies. We get this whole levirate marriage situation, which will show up again later in scripture. And the daughter-in-law that gets totally mistreated in this story ends up with her own little deceptive plan, and things end up working out for her in a weird way. We'll get there. I'm sure you guys know this story, but those of you who don't or who are going through the Bible for the first time, buckle up, it gets weird. Okay, let's just get our bearings again. Our author is Moses. The audience, the original people this was written for, were the Israelites about to enter the promised land about the same time as chapter 37. This is starting off as chapter 37 ends. So really, it is important. It seems like a non sequitur, like this weird little story that sticks out of nowhere. Why are we talking about this? I want to know what happened to Joseph. But the whole point of what happened to Joseph revolves around the influence of the Canaanites and why God had to get this family out of this area and into isolation in Egypt. And in Egypt, they were isolated in a way that they would not have been had they stayed in Canaan. And we see what happens when Judah intermarries with a Canaanite. So he's speaking to the Israelites before entering the promised land. It's about the same time. And this chapter will go about 22 years. It starts off when Joseph's 17 and sold into slavery and will go for about 22 years. And then when we flip to the chapter 39, it starts at about that time. It backs up a little and tells us how Joseph has been during this time in Egypt. So it needed to be here. If I was God wanting to express why I let this happen to my people, why I let them live in slavery for so long, I would want to explain to them that I had their best interest in heart. Not only did it fulfill prophecy, but it fulfilled their best interest. I was looking out for them. And this is exactly how and where and what exactly what I would do if I was wanting to get that point across, right? So that's where we are. And that's Moses in the picture, in case you're wondering who that weird guy is, right? So Judah is our highlighted character tonight. He is the fourth son of Jacob with Leah. Remember, Leah is the wife he didn't really want, but she was the fertile one. He's actually next in line. He's fourth. Normally, number one gets to be leader, right? Well, that was Reuben. You remember what happened with Reuben? Reuben got a little too big for his britches, decided he was going to have relations with his father's concubine wife, which is an overt act of usurping authority. He's saying, I'm ready to take over now. I'm taking over now. You're not dead yet, but you might as well be because I'm taking over, which Jacob didn't like too much. And that ruled Reuben out from getting to be the next leader, the next patriarch, right? The next two in line after Reuben, number two and number three, were Levi and Simeon. We know what they did at Shechem. That rules them out. They can't be leader because they used deception and lies to murder an entire town. And then all the brothers involved in the pillaging. So that's not cool. That's not going to work. So we've got number four, Judah, who we know does get the leadership and the blessing. Now, we know that Joseph gets some leadership too, but the spiritual blessing goes to Judah. And you're going to read this story and you're going to think, why? Why Judah? Why not Joseph? Joseph's honorable. Judah's a turkey. Judah makes wrong decision after wrong decision. But as we've seen, God doesn't use just perfect people. He uses the flawed and the broken. And Judah's nice and broken, so it works out. So it is through Judah that we do get King David and the Messiah. So the blessing does pass through Judah. And this not only tells us why God's people needed to get out of Dodge, But it also explains how Judah's heart was changed, how he went from selfish, self-righteous, hypocritical, nasty. His hard heart was softened and he was humbled. And this lesson, this narrative tells us how that happened. Hey, Island. Good to see you, girl. Glad to see you. I'm so glad you guys are here. Y'all make me feel so special that you want to hang out with me. Fun. All right. So our next character. Now, Judah's still a nomad. That's important. He doesn't own land. He is not some great chieftain. He is on his own. He's split from his family. So he doesn't have as much as he would if he had stuck around. He's still a nomad. The next character is who Judah marries. Now, some people think that her name is Shua, but she's actually referred to as Bathshua, the daughter of Shua. Shua is her dad. They have three sons, which might mean, remember, these names typically sound like a word that means whatever. So is the first son, and his name likely means watchful or vigilant. All right. Onan, the second son, means vigorous. And Shelah means maybe like drawn out, like is in the womb. Maybe he had some trouble being born or something like that. And our final character is Tamar, who is Judah's daughter-in-law, and her name means something along the lines of palm tree. Interesting, right? Come on down to Florida, you guys. It's rainy, but it's warm. I'll give you that. All right. So where are we? We're in chapter 38. Chapter 37 was when Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery at 17. Now, Judah, for some reason, splits off from his family. Now we've got the story of Judah and Tamar, and then chapter 39 jumps back to Joseph. So we're kind of in this camera shift moment. We're focusing on one of the other brothers. Now remember, chapter 37 and 38 seem like they're talking about Joseph and Judah, but they're really still talking about Jacob's family because he's still around. He's still the patriarch. And even though Judah has moved away, he's still one of Jacob's sons. It's not until the next chapter that we zoom in on Joseph and stay with him, essentially. Okay. So where are we? There are some locations I want to kind of give you a feeling for. First of all is Adullam. That is, all of these towns, interestingly, are in what would later become Judah's tribal territory, which I think is kind of neat. So Adullam is southwest of Jerusalem. It's in the northern area of the Judean lowlands. It was actually a Canaanite royal city, and it's associated with King David a lot. So you're going to see Adullam mentioned again, which I think is neat when you kind of get a bearing for where you are geographically. Kezib is near Hebron, about 3 miles west of Adullam. And this is a picture of Timnah, about 4 miles west of Beth Shemesh. I'm trying to give you guys kind of points if you've got a map in the back of your Bible or an online atlas of some kind so you can kind of figure out where you guys are. You can see it's on the border with what would become the Philistine territory. Okay, let's go. Verse 1, ready? At the time that Joseph was sold off into slavery, Judah left his brothers and settled near an Adullamite named Hira. There, Judah saw the daughter of a Canaanite named Shua. He took her as a wife and slept with her. Well, she conceived and gave birth to a son, and he named him She conceived again, gave birth to a son, and named him Onan. And I can't say that without thinking, Onan the Barbarian. Wasn't it Conan? Anyway, she gave birth to another son and named him Shelah. It was at Kezib that she gave birth to him. All right. So Judah separates from his family. It was his idea to sell Joseph instead of leave him for dead. Remember, they started off wanting to kill him. Then they're like, well, why get our hands dirty? He's already in a cistern. Let's just leave him there. He'll die eventually of his own accord, and we don't have to get our hands dirty. And he was the one that was like, well, actually, there's some traders over there. Let's just sell him as a slave. That way we don't have to kill him and we make a little money off of it. It was his idea. So was it that pushed him away from his family? Was it the guilt? Was it the discomfort? Was it being around his father who was in deep mourning all the time? Was it fear of the very same brothers that they could turn on him at any moment? I gotta say, I wouldn't be too comfortable around those guys, knowing what they're capable of. How many people do you know that are capable of murdering their own brother? Not just that, but 11 of them are all cool with it. Like, that is a dark family. That is deep. And remember, in this society, your closest relationship, your best friend, was not husband, wife. It was brothers. It was brothers. That was the number one relationship. So this would have been even more shocking back then. I think it's still pretty shocking today, but, you know, whatever. So Judah sets off for Adullam. He's got this buddy who is a Canaanite, a pagan. And he's like, I'm going to go over there and hang out with him. I'm going to live over there for a while. See ya. And he goes and he marries a Canaanite woman. He sees, just like it goes, it always goes with, they see something they like, they desire it, and they take it. And he finds a beautiful woman he wants as a wife. He says, she's pretty, I'd like her as a wife. Totally disregarding the fact that they are not supposed to intermarry with the locals. They know that. They all know that. They know it doesn't end well, but they do it anyway. He did it anyway. It was not allowed for a reason. The culture of these people, these weren't just like, oh, it's another religion, but they're generally kind of, you know, Judeo-Christian values. It's all, no, these pagans were deep, dark bad guys. There's a reason that God gave them a long time to figure it out, but eventually had to wipe them off the face of the earth because they were, you know, into the kind of thing like sacrificing your children. Pretty creepy stuff that you don't want to be a part of. And intermarrying will not only get rid of your culture, it gets rid of your morals and your values, and you become assimilated into this community that's much larger than you. And the Israelites, the Hebrews, they were just a young family. They didn't have the population mass to maintain their identity among a population of this size. They would have assimilated and eventually just disappeared and become Canaanites like everybody else. And God was protecting them from this. So, was it the willingness to sell other people into slavery? Honestly, the fact that slavery was the better of the choices really is scary. I probably would have left too, knowing what my brothers were capable of. Yeah, Kezib. So that's probably how it's pronounced. You're right, Glenn. Kezib is probably the better pronunciation. I think Hebrew CH is kuh. I'm terrible with Hebrew. Judah got a wife for his firstborn. You know, that's his job. And her name was Tamar. Now, Judah's firstborn was evil in the Lord's sight, and the Lord put him to death. What did he do? I'd kind of like to know. But we don't get to know. All we get to know is that God judged him as evil, and zap, he's dead. I don't know. How many of you guys have read the Francine Rivers Lineage of Grace? She did a story that's fiction about Tamar, and the way she described was this horribly crude, evil, dark man, and he's at dinner with the whole family, and God just, boop, drops him dead. It's just kind of, it's so dramatic, but I think it would have needed to be in front of people for people to know it wasn't Tamar who had killed him, you know? It's not like they had forensic scientists or anything. Hebrew. I can do the Greek. I cannot do the Hebrew very well. Okay, so Tamar loses her husband. Well, widows really have it rough in that culture. You couldn't own property. You couldn't inherit your husband's property. Not much left for you to do, except for this cultural thing we'll talk about in a minute. Then Judah said to Onan, who was brother number two, sleep with your brother's wife, perform your duty as her brother-in-law, and produce offspring for your brother. This is what we now call a levirate marriage. And we'll talk about this in more detail in a second, but it was to protect the family name because people did die often and for various reasons, you know, famine, war, all that stuff, disease. So a way to protect the widow and to protect the husband who had died from being wiped out of memory and to protect the family from losing that lineage was that the next one in line, the next kinsman redeemer, as we saw in Ruth, would have the option to step up to the plate, marry the widow, and the first son they would have would belong to the dead brother. It would get his name and it would inherit for him so that the widow would have a son if something happened to the next husband. So she would have a son to protect her in her old age, to provide for, because she couldn't own any property. She couldn't have any. She didn't have anybody. If the older members of the family died before she did, and remember, the wife was usually a little younger, she was up a creek if she didn't have a son. So this was to protect her, and it was to give that inheritance to that firstborn son of the new relationship, right? And then after that, the sons would belong to the second brother. So it seems in this case that Judah, now remember, the levirate marriage was, it was instituted a long time ago, way before it was put down into the law in Deuteronomy. But in Deuteronomy, it is put down in Hebrew law as a way to protect the widow. But it gave them the option, because it does take a certain level of selflessness to say, I'm going to do this to honor my brother, even though it is to my personal detriment. Now, this is way before that, like 400 years before that. And so it seems in this culture and time, the levirate marriage was forced by Judah. And Judah, being the patriarch of this family unit, Onan didn't have a choice. He had to. Okay, verse 9. But Onan knew that the offspring would not be his. So whenever he slept with his brother's wife, he released his seed on the ground so that he would not produce offspring for his brother. What he did was evil in the Lord's sight. So he put him to death also. God's got opinions about this, right? So the boys grow up, right? We start off with Judah getting married, has three sons. They grow up to the point where they're ready to get married, you know, teenage years, mid to late teenage years, most likely, kind of right after they hit puberty, essentially. Judah arranges a marriage for his oldest. And according to rabbinic tradition, now this is not scripture. This is rabbinic tradition. This is oral tradition passed down, may or may not be true. According to tradition, his sin, Ur's sin, was not wanting to consummate the marriage with Tamar because she was so beautiful, he did not want to mar her beauty with pregnancy. I don't know if that's true or not. I think it's fascinating. And it would be a sin against her because she needed a son for her protection. She needed it for her livelihood. And the fact that he wasn't willing to give her a son is selfish on his part. He's saying, I would prefer to look at you and your beauty than to give you what you need for survival. It was an awful thing. And that would have been enough for God to say, you're not following my commands. My commands are multiply and fill the earth, right? That's Onan Island. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. You are ahead of me. Onan is the next guy. So the levirate marriage is actually in Hebrew, yibam, from the Latin levir, meaning a husband's brother. The brother of the deceased man was called a yavam, and the wife was called yavamah in Hebrew. And so like we said, if one brother left a childless or sonless widow, because a little girl wouldn't do her any good, the next brother in line could and should marry the widow. This is the only time that marrying a brother's wife is allowed. Their first son would legally belong to the dead brother, and that son would inherit his dead father's land and wealth. This is important. It kept a family line from dying out, and it protected her, and it kept her in the family because she belonged to this family now. She can't just go home. She belongs to this new family, and it gives her a way to remarry and stay in that family. Yeah, island's on top of it, dude. So we talked about how in Deuteronomy, it's desired but not mandatory, but here it's mandatory. Now, what's neat in Deuteronomy, if the person declines to marry his brother's widow, she is allowed to publicly shame him for doing so. Remember, in an honor shame culture, being shamed is the worst thing of the worst. You know, it would be horrifying. So he would definitely want to if he had it in his character to do so. But it does take a level of selflessness to do that for your brother and for his widow. Here, it shows that it was the responsibility of the father-in-law to ensure that it happened, and he did not give an option to Onan. Later, that responsibility moves to the brothers of the deceased to make the decision. Now, the reason that this was controversial and that some might have wanted to decline, because what it does is it takes the firstborn's share that would otherwise go to that second brother in more even form and gives it to the dead brother's firstborn, who would now be your firstborn instead of you. It dramatically decreases your inheritance. You can see why they would have a little bit of a, do I want to be the kinsman redeemer? Do I want to be the levirate? I don't know. It takes a level of selflessness. Now, what's neat is this was not just a Hebrew thing. Like I said, this had been cultural for a long time before that. The Hebrew law just laid down the rules that had already been in place. And this is God saying, I'm good with this. This is how I want you to do things. This levirate marriage was actually also found in the Hittite law number 193, in which the brother marries the widow with or without children. It doesn't specify. And then the father marries if no brother. So again, stays in the family, which may be why Tamar took it upon herself to seduce Judah, because in her culture, that was kind of the next step. If you're not going to give me to his brother, you owe me. It's your turn to step up. It's also found in the ancient Nuzi documents from about the mid-second millennium BC and in Middle Assyrian Empire documents from the 14th to the 15th century BC. So this was a cultural phenomenon for a long time in that area. I think that's kind of cool. Okay. Widows. We talked about how widows were really vulnerable. Women did not have rights. Now, this is not the Bible saying women should not have rights. This is the Bible reflecting accurately the history of the time, the real people in a real time, in real places, living real lives. And it's going to include the dirty, and it's going to include the ugly, and it's going to include the sinful, and it's going to include the honorable. And God gives us plenty of instruction to figure out which is which, right? So widows could be formed for a million reasons: warfare, famine, disease, all sorts of stuff, right? And they're unable to inherit their husband's wealth. If their husband dies, they don't get it. Someone else gets it. It's not fair at all. And so this system would protect her. And a widow would have to wear special garments for a while. No veil was allowed for a widow or a married woman. This is important in our story. A veil will come up again. Now, another way that widows were protected is they had special gleaning rights, meaning they could come behind the people who were gleaning the field, who were chopping down like the crops, and anything dropped or not picked up, they were allowed to pick up and feed themselves with so they wouldn't starve. And it was up to the person who owns the field to make sure that that was left. And the outsides of the fields were left for them as well. God's law really laid that down in black and white. You needed to protect your widows in this way. And actually, the Hebrew system also had portions of the tithe that went to the synagogue were actually for the widows to take care of them when they had no one else. Now, returning home, you're not allowed to go home when you're a widow. Your husband dies, you don't go home. You stay with that family. They're your new family. You may or may not remarry from there, but that's your new family. Only the widowed daughter of a priest was allowed to return home with honor. Now, I'm not saying you weren't allowed to go home. I'm saying you're not allowed to go home with honor. And it was up to your father whether or not to let you back in the house. He didn't have to. You weren't his daughter anymore. You belong to that new family. That's just the culture. Right. She's no longer under the care of her father's house. Absolutely, Island. She belongs to that new extended family. She belongs to them. She is their responsibility. It's their job to take care of her. Okay, so Onan is told to step up to the plate. He doesn't have a choice. But he knows that instead of getting, and this would be if the inheritance was split evenly, which it often wasn't. The firstborn often got a larger inheritance or all of the inheritance. So Onan would go from, if he did this and gave her a son, he would go from getting half of the inheritance or all of it to getting a third or a fourth of the inheritance. So it really decreased his potential wealth. And we know a person's character by the choices they make, right? And so we learn a little bit about Onan and his character here. And he did something unthinkable in that time, place, and culture. He wasted and spilled his seed. What this did is it's denying Tamar her right to have a child to protect her in her old age. It's denying his dead brother what's due him. It's essentially killing any future offspring that would have come from that. And it's treating her like a common harlot. It's worse. It's treating her almost incestually. Because the levirate marriage made it okay. And you were doing a good thing for your dead brother. You were being honorable and honoring and taking care of that widow and taking care of his future, the dead brother. But what he did, he was denying that. And so by not making it a legitimate levirate marriage, he's treating her extremely poorly. And the word used here is not just when he went to her, whenever. He did this repeatedly. And anecdotally, colloquially, the act that he does here is sometimes referred to as onanism. So if you've ever heard that, that's what that comes from. Now, I want to make sure you understand that this is not God saying that that particular act of family planning is sinful. He's not commenting on that, good or bad or indifferent. He's commenting on what Onan is doing to Tamar and to his dead brother. He is dishonoring her. He is dishonoring his dead brother. He is dishonoring his father, and he's dishonoring God. He is doing what he wants to do. He is taking her for his own pleasure and gratification and giving nothing back to her. It is an extremely horrible thing that he did, and it makes perfect sense that God would strike him dead because that is a horrible thing that he's doing. He's sinning against all of them. So he takes advantage of Tamar. He does not give her anything in return. He's not taking responsibility for her as he should. And it was God's command to multiply. What he does is, like I said, he turns levirate marriage into an incest. It's terrible. And like I said, not just once, he did it repeatedly over. He did not ever intend to give her a child, which was very dangerous for her. So Judah's response, I love how the formatting goes all wonky on this stuff, don't you? All right, Island, what you got to say? It's interesting because traditionally, take a husband's name wasn't about asserting ownership, but reminding him of his responsibility to take care of her, even above himself. Very well said. You know, I hadn't really thought of it that way. But I agree, because in a culture where women have very few rights, you're depending on the men in your life to take up that helm of responsibility. And as we've seen, the men in this family aren't too good at doing. They're not great about honoring their first and only wife the way God intended marriage to be. They're not great at that. They're not great at stepping up and problem solving. They're not great at making the right decisions for their family. And it's been passed down, it looks like, to where Judah is making the same mistakes. He's not taking responsibility. He's passed this on to his sons who aren't taking responsibility. They're not being honorable. They're not doing the right thing. So rather than recognizing that it even could be his son's choices that caused God's judgment, it's easier to blame Tamar. Because if he recognized the sin in his sons, he'd have to recognize the sin in himself. It's really hard to see your own sin. You don't want to see it, and especially in your children, because that typically reflects your own sins, because they see what, you know, you do and they reflect that. So I was asking myself, maybe was he unaware of the evil or the selfishness of his children? And I've got to say probably not, because they were of marrying age. And honestly, these personality traits are there from the beginning. We are who we are, and unless we drastically change through something like salvation and the sanctification process, we're not likely to change. And so these characteristics and these traits would have been there from childhood. Did Judah's selfishness rub off on his sons? I mean, we've seen this. It carries on. And the fact that his mother, who is even unnamed, was likely pagan. I mean, that culture just wasn't known for being honorable and loving and stepping up to the plate and being selfless. It was more about trying to control your own fate. I know, Island's on it tonight, man. Verse 11, then Judah said to his daughter-in-law Tamar, remain a widow in your father's house until my son Shelah grows up. For he thought he might die too, like his brothers. So Tamar went to live in her father's house. What Judah does here is horrible. Horrible. Once married, the woman belonged in the new family. It was his responsibility. Even if he didn't marry her off to Sheila for whatever reason, it was his responsibility as the patriarch of that family to take care of her. She was his responsibility to take care of as long as he could. And not only that, her father... Okay, remember when they get married, the groom pays the family of the bride a price. Typically, that father is supposed to hold that money back in case the unthinkable happens and the whole family dies off or abandons her and she ends up back at home. It's to kind of take care of her in that situation. It's like a life insurance policy for their marriage. It was up to the father to take care of that money, make sure it was allotted properly, and sometimes it did or didn't happen, but that's what it was for. Him sending her back to her father is so shameful. It would have been horrible. Not only has she lost two husbands who likely didn't treat her very well from what we know, her father-in-law, who is supposed to be her great patriarch, her great protector, abandons her. Not only that, he prevents her from getting remarried. She can't go out and get remarried. Even nobody would want her because she's been married before. She's a twice widow. She's, you know, she's not like a young virgin. She's a married woman who's a widow twice, you know, in that society. I mean, people did die, but I mean, she wasn't the most marketable young thing on whatever dating app you can imagine at the time, right? So it was extremely shameful. And the fact that her father let her back in speaks pretty well for her father because he didn't have to, right? It implies that she did something wrong to displease her husband or her father-in-law, her new father. It implies she did something to shame that family and therefore bring shame on her original family. She has nothing she can do. There's no legal redress for her. She's stuck at the whim of the men in her life. And like I said, she's unable to be remarried, even if someone would want her, because Judah says, I've engaged you to Sheila, even though he has no intention of giving her to Sheila. He engages her to Sheila, which is a contract in that culture. Marriages had two stages, the engagement and the wedding. And the engagement was like the contract. Like, you didn't live together, but you were ostensibly belonging to each other, and it would take a divorce to break that contract. So Judah's acting very deceptively here, and he's ruining any chance for Tamar to have any sort of future whatsoever. He's not only removed himself from his responsibility to her, he's ruined any chance for her to have a future outside of his accountability. It's horrible. It's the worst thing I can imagine happening to her in that situation, right? So verse 12, after a long time, Judah's wife, the daughter of Shua, died. When Judah had finished mourning, he and his friend Hira, the Adullamite, went up to Timnah to his sheep shearers. Now, sheep shearing was kind of the culmination of the whole season. You would have your sheep shorn. It was this really big event where all the people would come together and try to do all the labor together as quickly as possible. And at the end of it, it was work hard, play hard. At the end of it, there was this big party and festivals like payday. And it often involved, you know, partying. It was a big hoo-ha. And he's apparently done mourning his wife and ready to go boogie. And so he's like, I'll go up with the sheep shears. And Tamar was told, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep. So she took off her widow's clothes, veiled her face, covered herself, and sat at the entrance to Enaim, which is on the way to Timnah. So she goes in his path. She knows where he's going, and she sets herself in his path and dresses in a way that would imply that she's a cult prostitute, right? Now, for she saw that though Sheila had grown up, she had not been given to him as a wife. Time has passed. Some serious time has passed. Long enough for Sheila to grow up and for her to realize that he is never going to fulfill his vow to me. He's never going to do it. But again, she has no choice about the matter. She's engaged to him. She can't go get remarried. There's nothing she can do. Now, verse 15, when Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute, for she'd covered her face. She was dressed like one. And that's a thing back then. So the language indicates that this is about a year later, maybe more, depending on what you read. But one I read said about a year later. Again, the sheep shearing was this big party and festival. Tamar's keeping up with the status of her family, of her, you know, new family. She knows Judah's wife has died. She knows Shelah has grown up and that Judah was just not planning to honor his word. He just wasn't. She knew that. So Tamar felt like she was owed a child by this family. And according to that culture and some of the things we found archaeologically, it looks like the next step was for the father-in-law to give her a child. Again, it was for her protection. It was a way to take care of her. And at the very least, keep her in his household and protect her and care for her. Now, where is Enam? Some places are like, we don't know, but it's probably Enam. So if you're looking for that on your map, look for Enam. Verse 16. So this is Judah. He went over to her and said, come, let me sleep with you. Real subtle. For he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. She said, what do you give me for sleeping with me? And he said, well, I'll send you a young goat for my flock, he replied. But she said, only if you leave something with me until you send it. I mean, she's no fool. She's not going to be like, yeah, I'll take your word for it. We know what your word means, Judah. Not much, right? So his proposition to her, the words that we translate into her are likely and often a little bit nicer and PG than what the Hebrew actually means here. If you can imagine the four-letter word for that act, that's pretty much what that means. He's pretty much walking up to her and saying this very crude and very direct proposition. I mean, he's dealing with a prostitute. And what he's intending to do is sleep with a temple prostitute. Now, these temple prostitutes would position themselves in places around town, and it was a great way for these cult religions that actually started in Mesopotamia to bring in converts, because as part of worship, you would reenact the divine marriage act between the fertility gods, right? Ishtar and Baal, or Anat and El. And it involves what you think it involves. And it was a way to promote fertility, because remember, the pagan gods, the idols, were a way to try to control the uncontrollable. They're in direct opposition to the one living God, the true God. We submit to, because he's all powerful. He's all knowing. He's got everything. There's nothing we can give him, and we're not going to control him. We're going to submit to his already perfect and good will. In contrast to that, you have these cult idols that were really developed as a way to try to control the uncontrollable, to try to take control over those things in your life that you really have nothing to do with, like whether or not your crops are going to fail, whether or not your kid's going to survive, whether or not you're going to die of a weird disease, whether or not you're going to be attacked by a roaming raiding party. It was an attempt to try to control the uncontrollable. And by doing certain things, by worshiping certain ways, you were attempting to control that God who was in charge of that thing. It was really just a way to try to take some control back in life without submitting to God. They're in direct opposition. So by engaging in this particular act of worship, you were forcing those gods to give you what you wanted fertility-wise, be it crops, be it with your wife, be it with your lambs, whatever. It was a way to try to force that god to give you what you wanted. Not only that, they wanted to do it anyway, right? And it was a way for them to engage in that activity without guilt or shame. Now, they dressed in these veils, symbolic of being the bride of the male consort. And the men would visit before any big events needing fertility. And like I said, they were reenacting a divine marriage between the goddess and the god. So she is pretending to be one of those, and she's hiding her identity. Because remember, a married woman or a widow would never wear a veil. Verse 18. No, she's not going to just take his word for it. He's got to give her something if she's going to do this, right? Well, what should I give you? He asked. Because he doesn't come prepared. This was an impulse, obviously. She answered, your signet ring, your cord, and the staff in your hand. So he gave them to her and slept with her. And she became pregnant by him. She got up and left, then removed her veil and put her widow's clothes back on. when Judah sent the young goat by his friend, the Adullamite, in order to get back the items he had left with the woman, he couldn't find her. He asked the men of the place, well, where's the cult prostitute who was beside the road at Anam? There's been no cult prostitute here, they answered. Okay, so he didn't bring a goat or anything to pay off the prostitute. So he wasn't planning to do this. He just saw her and acted on impulse, which tells us more about his character. He's impulsive. Now let's talk about these items he left. The staff, a person's staff, especially a leader, a patriarch, or a man of any wealth and means, would have a nice fancy staff. It was theirs. They would use it for all sorts of stuff. Remember, everything had lots of purposes. Your coat had tons of purposes. Your staff was used for walking. It was used for weapons. It was used for all sorts of weird stuff. It was your identity. So they would often have these brass toppers on them that would have like animal heads, like a lion's head or something, or it'd be engraved real pretty and polished. It would be yours and you would use it every day, all day. And so you put some time and money into it, right? It was kind of your identifier. And they found these, tons of these in the archaeological digs, which is really cool. And it was a symbol of power or leadership. If you were important enough to have a staff, and the fancier the staff, the more important you were, right? It makes sense. Animal goading was another use for it. Now, the seal they talk about was like a necklace. Sometimes you see them later on used on rings, but it was your signet, as in what would later become our signature. It was the way you signed documents. It's how you identified yourself. It was essentially your driver's license, your passport, and your signature all in one. And it was who you are. And you would roll it either flat side and squish it or roll the round side. I can't figure out which one at this time it was. And it would have an inscription in it and would leave an indentation identifying who you were. And so you would put, they would drill a hole through it somehow, obviously not a drill, but they would put a hole through it and wear it on a cord. And that's what he left with her because those were his two identifying marks. Those were identifying who he is. And she's pretty sure he's not going to leave her high and dry. And she's got something to identify him by if he does. And she wants to go make good on the deal. They were often carved from semi or precious stones. And it was like extension of yourself. It wasn't just like a piece of plastic you could replace real cheap. It was who you were. It was like a credit card because you would sign off documents, contracts, buying and selling stuff using your seal. So he's leaving his credit card with her. It was a very valuable item and it was very identifying. And he didn't even know her name. When he went to go pay it back, he didn't even have a name to identify her by, just the girl, right? The woman. A shrine prostitute, same thing. Yep, absolutely. So the Adullamite returns to Judah and says, I couldn't find her. And besides, the men of the place said, there's been no cult prostitute here. So Judah's like, oh, great. I'll let her keep the items for herself. Otherwise, we'll become a laughing stock. After all, I did send this young goat, but you couldn't find her. He's like, I did my due diligence. I've done enough. People are going to start laughing at me if I keep going with this. Just let it go. Now, yep, seal the deal. That's right, Glenn. Good point. After about 3 months later, Judah's told, because about 3 months is when a woman starts to show, your daughter-in-law, Tamar, has been acting like a common harlot, a prostitute, and now she's pregnant. Judah's response, get this. Bring her out, Judah said, and let her be burned to death. Hypocrite much? I mean, my goodness. When he says bring her out, what that means, it refers to the city gate because that's where the town leaders would sit during the day. And that's where the judgments would be. It's where all deals were sealed, where you would have, you know, certain contracts verified and witnessed. And it's where all judgment and legal stuff happened. So it's essentially bring her out, let her be judged guilty because obviously she's pregnant. Obviously she's not married. She deserves to die because that's the rule. Now, he is in charge of her life and death. He gets to say whether she lives, dies, or whatever. He's in charge of her. And this goes to show that even though she's living under her father's house, her father-in-law has authority over her, which means he should have been responsible for her. Notice it's her father that's paying for her room and board this entire time, not her father-in-law, who should be, right? So he drags her out to the city gates to be judged a harlot and be stoned to death, which is what the end point of that was. Now, in Hebrew law, it was supposed to be both. The man and the woman were supposed to be stoned to death, which is really interesting, right? So Judah is like, phew, I finally got a reason to get rid of this lady. I want her out of my family. I want her out of my life. Finally got a reason to get rid of her. Now, what he does is so much worse than what he had to do, because a burning to death is a horrible way to go, and it was reserved for the worst of the worst. Now, the punishment for harlotry or adultery was being stoned to death, which is bad enough, but being burned to death is a lot worse, and it was more shameful, right? Other times, if you weren't to be stoned to death, you were strangled to death. That was how they would kill you if they didn't stone you publicly. Now, the burning, like I said, was reserved for the worst of the worst. So he's really condemning her to death in a painful way. He's saying, don't just let her die. Let it be horrible and shameful. He's acting out of hate and vengeance here. Now, some people think that maybe it referred to being burned after being stoned to death. But I'm one that takes the straightforward as the straightforward, unless there's some clear cultural indicator. Otherwise, take the Bible at face value there. Now, this burning was reserved for those, the worst of the worst, as in a daughter of a priest being caught in incest or adultery or an incest case. So he was condemning her to the worst of the worst, calling her the worst of the worst. It was shaming her. He is so hypocritical here. Now, what's ironic is in condemning her to that depth and degree, he's condemning himself because he was the partner and it was supposed to be both of them that were stoned to death, right? Now, eventually his identity comes out. So why wasn't he stoned to death? Interesting. He has authority over life and death for Tamar, but someone who, like at the city gate, would have had to demand his stoning at that point, and apparently nobody did. Apparently, because otherwise they had every right to demand it. And her method is so brilliant. What she does is so smart. She indirectly accuses him. She could have come out swinging and brought out the staff and the seal and said, look, it was him that did it. It was him, and humiliated him. But that would have left him more angry, more vengeful. What she does is she leaves him an out. She leaves him a bridge. And they always say to leave your enemy a bridge to retreat on. And she does that. She leaves him a way to recover. And she does. He's still exposed publicly as a hypocrite, but she doesn't directly accuse him. She indirectly accuses him. Now, she could escalate it quickly, I imagine. You know, I imagine the seal people would have known was Judah's if she had to, but she did the graceful thing first. Verse 25, as she was being brought out, she sent her father-in-law this message, which I think is so risky because who's to say they would have delivered this message? I am pregnant by the man to whom these items belong. And she added, examine them. Whose signet cord, ring cord, and staff are these? And Judah recognized them and said, oh, she's more in the right than I, since I did not give her to my son, Sheila. And he did not know her intimately again. Okay, in saying she's more righteous than I is not saying that what she did was a righteous act, but he's finally humbling himself and saying, oh, I see. I get it. And I get why she did it. He understands at least. It was not more righteous to sleep with one's father-in-law. Notice he did not sleep with her again, right? He didn't marry her. He took her under his household and raised her children as his children, but it doesn't say that got married, and it specifically says they did not have that relationship in that way again. It ostensibly did not result in a marriage because that would have been wrong. I think we don't know. It doesn't say, so we can't assume. But he did bring her into his household and raise those children. And we know that because the firstborn of those children became the ancestor of King David and the Messiah. Talk about God using some flawed people, right? He neglected her morally, and she exposed his sin. She exposed his neglect. She exposed his sleeping with someone outside of a marriage relationship. And this act and the way she did it so wisely and publicly,
So he couldn't, you know, she knew he was deceitful. She knew she couldn't go to him one-on-one and trust him to be do the right thing. She had to wait and do it publicly. When he condemned her, which he would eventually find out and do, she knew she had to do this publicly and have a way to prove it. And so this humbled him because it was a public shaming, essentially. The shame turned on Judah, and he had to take a minute and go, oh. You know, it was a real tough moment for him. And instead of doubling down and getting more angry, because he really couldn't, he was caught. It humbled him. It softened his heart. It humbled him and brought his heart around to full repentance. It didn't have to. It could have just humbled him and shamed him, but it did. He took that opportunity and his heart changed and he did the right thing. And we see this change in his heart. And this is important. This is very important that God will often use these horrible moments in our lives to humble us and to bring to light something in our lives. Have you ever been tempted to condemn someone for something that you are guilty of yourself and you don't even notice? That's why that Bible verse talks about, you know, don't try to take a splinter out of your brother's eye while you got a log in your eye. It's look at yourself first. It doesn't say don't judge. It says you're going to be judged by the same measure you judge others. So be careful in your judgment. Be wise, be discerning, but be graceful. Don't be quick to condemn. Interesting. Now, this is possibly why this redemption moment is possibly why he was not excluded from his father's blessing, as were his older three brothers, because we don't hear anything about them repenting in this way. And it's through Judah that the patriarchal blessing flows. And this moment, because of Tamar, is why his heart changed, making him eligible for that spiritual blessing. Island, yeah, Judah did have an oh crap moment. Glenn, absolutely. Oops. Island said, since her sons were from Judah, would they still be considered her deceased husband's offspring or their brothers? Very good question. I can't believe I forgot to mention this. This would have been a levirate marriage, ostensibly. It would have taken the place. He lost two sons, and this is to replace the two sons. Perez, the oldest, would have been his son, his firstborn, and the next one would have been his secondborn, and Sheila would have still been like his thirdborn. These sons would have replaced his two dead sons. So you see how God restores. And not only that, he restores evil, horrible men with what I would hope would be raised to be kinder men because Judah's heart's changed and Tamar's heart's in a better place, right? I hope. Verse 27, let's finish up. When the time came for her to give birth, there were twins in her womb and she was giving birth. One of them put out his hand and the midwife took it and tied a scarlet thread around it, announcing this one came out first, but then he pulled his hand back and out came his brother. And she said, what a breakout you have made for yourself. So he was named Perez. Then his brother, who had the scarlet thread tied to his hand, came out and he was named Zerah. So God used Tamar to humble Judah and continue his line through these children. And like we said, two for two, right? Perez means breaking out. And through his descendants came the Messiah, which I think is so fascinating because we want Joseph to get the spiritual blessing. We want Joseph, who's righteous and honorable and good, as we will see in the next chapter, we want him to get the blessing. But God chooses a broken, humbled sinner instead. And I think there's something powerful there. Zerah, the second son, means brightness or scarlet to resemble the thread from his wrist, we think probably. The children, what's interesting here is these children bore no hint of illegitimacy because of the way the culture looked at this kind of levirate marriage situation. It wasn't called that at the time, but it was the same idea. It was culturally standard at that time to do that, to replace the dead husbands, right? So they were not considered illegitimate, apparently. And the twins, like I said, were possibly to compensate for the loss of Judah's two sons. And what this is a huge turning point in the ancestry. You've got 10 generations between Perez and King David. And 10, all the numbers in Hebrew and all the letters mean something. And the number 10 for Hebrews signified something complete and a significant unit of time. So this was a big turning point for the history of the Israelite people. So let's get to application. What's the point? Why is this here? Well, one, it showed why this family couldn't stay in Canaan because they were going to intermarry. As much as God said, don't do this, they were going to do it. It was going to happen. And it would have destroyed this entire family. They would have disappeared into the culture and the faith with it. It would have disappeared. And God knew that, and he protected them from it. This shows what happens when you intermarry. The children become like the pagans. They have that same system of beliefs because it's usually the mother who raises the children to have the religious upbringing. So, well, Judah was condemning Tamar to the worst death. When he himself was the other party, he was also condemning himself. And the point here, I think, is obvious. We should avoid condemning others, especially when we're guilty of the same thing. Now, what's different is what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit doesn't condemn. The Spirit convicts. The difference is purpose. Condemnation is to shame someone, right? To curse them, to shame them, bring them low. To convict is to say, hey, you're doing this wrong. Why don't you fix it so I can lift you up? It's to change and be lifted up. And that's what the Spirit does. He wants us to fix it so that we can be restored, right? So just as the brothers tried to hinder God's plan for Joseph to rule the family, Judah tried to keep Tamar from taking on her God-given role in the family. Both failed. Every time people in history try to thwart God's plan, pittance. It's not going to work. It never works. And this is just showing us that it's not going to work. That no matter how big and tough and strong we are, there's nothing we can do to thwart God's ultimate plan. We can choose to be a part of it or we can choose not to be a part of it, but God's plan is going to continue regardless, which I think is really reassuring. I really do. I think that's very reassuring. Next, how will God protect this family from assimilation with the Canaanites, which was demonstrated here is so wrong. So what he does is he sends them to Egypt, where this family will go from about 70 members to potentially millions, right? They think somewhere between 1 to 2 million as they left Egypt. And this would not have happened without assimilation had they not been in Egypt, where they were culturally isolated from the rest. They don't just become Egyptian. They become enslaved, which protects them from assimilation. So by being enslaved, they were being protected. Do you think they felt that way? Do you think they felt like God was protecting them at that moment? Probably not. I can't imagine that they would. But we can look back and see God's beautiful plan in hindsight. And I think we need to remember that in our lives. When it feels like we are being mistreated, when we feel like the worst has happened, and how could God possibly let this happen? We have to trust that, yes, there are bad things, and that doesn't make them any less miserable, bad, evil. It doesn't make slavery any less horrible and against God's will. But God can use anything. He can use the worst thing that could happen to you, and he could bring some good out of it. Now, the key to that is the rest of the verse that we typically quote, that, you know, God wants good things to happen for us, for those who are called according to, who live in his will and are called according to his purpose, who love the Lord. It's two sides. You love the Lord and your actions reflect that. You're called according to his purpose. It's not just that you love God, but you live how you want. You love God and you're called according to his purpose. And within that will, with staying within that, holding his hands, he's going to make sure you don't stumble and fall or don't go too far. He's going to look out for you, and you can trust that no matter how bad things get, he's looking out for you and he will make something good come of it. I can personally attest to this. I've had times in my life when I was first diagnosed, my health deteriorated so fast and it felt like my entire world fell apart. Everything that I had felt was my security was gone all at once. And God used that for some amazing things. I mean, we're talking amazing things that never would have happened, to the point where I can't look back and say that I would want it any other way. And we just have to trust, because in that moment, it didn't feel like God could use and possibly use this for good.
But he does. He does. He's got it all worked out. We just have to do our part. Make sure we stay in relationship with him and that we're called according to his purpose. Right? That we're putting him first, that we're submitting and trying to live an honorable and holy life. That doesn't mean that if we fail to do so, that we're condemned. We are still his children. He's just going to be there to brush us off, pick us up, and hold our hand and keep walking with us. Okay. Perez became the head of the leading clan in Judah and the ancestor of David. That's right. Yep, exactly what happened to Jesus and Mary in Luke chapter 2. God told Joseph to take the child and his mother to Egypt. There's so many similarities, so many prophetic things pointing to Christ when you look at Joseph. It is so cool. So keep that list going. Compare and contrast Joseph and Judah. And that's another reason this story, I think, is included here, because we're meant to look at Judah and compare him to Joseph and go, what happened there? They grew up in the same household and they are opposites. Joseph is sold into slavery. He has every right to pity himself and to just sulk and to feel like nothing's fair and he doesn't deserve this. But instead, he loves the Lord with all his heart and he does his job to honor God. He's the best slave that Egypt had ever seen. And God blessed it and blessed him. And it used him according to his will to do amazing things. I think that's another life lesson, you know, how we look at the simplest assignments in our life. No matter how small you feel like your job in life is right now, God can do some pretty amazing things when you do that job as if unto the Lord. I heard the saying, you know, if you're the only job you can find in the world is sweeping a floor, be the best sweeper that a company's ever seen, because you're doing it for God, not for yourself, not for the company, not for anybody else, but you're doing it for God. If you're raising a child, do it for God. If anything, do it as if you're doing it directly for God, because you are. And he can do great things with the smallest acts of faithfulness. Right? Why would God use Judah as the ancestor of the Messiah if Joseph was prophesied to rule? I had this question on Sunday, and it was a great question, because we see these dreams that Joseph is prophesied to be the sheaf of wheat standing and his brothers bowing. And then in the celestial dream, he is bowed down to by his father, his mother, and his brothers. Okay, so you think, well, he's the one that dad picked to lead. And clearly God wants him to be in charge of these brothers. So why isn't he the one that's going to get the spiritual blessing? We want him to get the spiritual blessing. He's the good guy. But it doesn't work out that way. Joseph was only prophesied to rule those in his immediate family, right? He saves their lives during a famine. He's prophesied in that sense, in that picture. And that's great. That's awesome for Joseph. But Judah was whose God's long-term plan was through. God doesn't only use the perfect and the holy and the righteous. Not that Joseph was perfect, but he doesn't only use the righteous. He can take a broken and contrite heart and do amazing things through that. He was fourth in line after those disqualified. And Jacob, his father, blesses Judah and gives the leadership role to him for his ancestors in the long run. We see that in Genesis 49. Now, what's neat is later on, the southern kingdom is named after Judah and the northern kingdom is named after Israel, right? But it's often referred to as Joseph. So they are kind of opposites, which I thought was kind of neat. All right. To what degree does the way a child is raised influence the way they parent? So look at Joseph and look at Judah and see, look at Jacob, look at all of these patriarchs. And you see this, for the most part, consistency with how they're raised is how they're going to parent. But then again, Joseph and Judah were raised in the same household. So faithfulness can go a long way in fixing some pretty bad things. You can be the end of whatever cycle of disaster or even little things in your family. You don't have to pass them on. Sanctification, softening of your heart,
can change things forever. You can start a cycle of positive change, blessing, of goodness being passed down in your family, in your extended family, versus passing down the same old mistakes. It can start with you by God changing your heart. Be open to that. And this is for you to chew on. What does God value as the most important characteristic in leaders and why? We'll talk about that next week a little bit more, but I want to leave you with that one so you can chew on it a little bit this week. And what do you think the most important characteristic to God is when he's choosing a leader? And a massive list of references there. All right, guys. I hope you enjoyed the craziness. Next week is also going to be a little crazy. It's a fun story. I love talking about Joseph and his spirals down and his ascents and his spirals down and his ascents. He stays faithful. And I find it so inspiring how God can use someone faithfully following him, even in the worst of situations, the worst of circumstances. Our circumstances don't determine our peace and our joy and our happiness. Our salvation does. Our God does. He is so much deeper and more important than any circumstance. So anyway, I hope you have a wonderful weekend and a wonderful week. Don't forget to vote in the poll if it's still up and let me know what you think. And you guys have an absolutely wonderful time. I pray for you always. I hope you stay happy and healthy and wholesome. And I will catch you later. Good night, guys. Bye. I'd say bye with the pooches, but they're already asleep.